Hi, everybody. I'm Crandall.
I'm Mercy.
We are armchair directors.
It's not the years, honey. It's the mileage. And that was in his 40s when he first said that. I wonder how he feels now in his 80s. But we are joined by Ed Dolista of the IndyCast. Welcome, Ed. It's so great to have you on here.
Thanks so much for inviting me. It's great to see you guys again.
If adventure has a name, it's Ed Dolista.
We had the pleasure of being on the IndyCast many, many years ago. Time flies way too quickly. Mm-hmm. And we've been meaning to have you back on here. And I can't believe it's been over a decade, but we finally got you on here to talk all things indie, not just the new one coming up. Mm-hmm. The original trilogy for the old school fans. So what should we kick it off with? Dial of Destiny chat?
I'm always happy to talk anything Indiana Jones. We won't go into spoiler territory, no. Hopefully. So
issue is our Matt, what's our motto?
Our motto is usually spoilers forever, but I think we generally say once the movie has come out that's
right. Yes,
when it's fair. Okay. Game.
So just a heads up, I spoiled the whole movie for myself because I love spoilers. My attitude towards spoilers is I'm not addicted to the thrill in the movie. And the way I look at it is every movie I love is spoiled. Like any movie I've watched a second time has been spoiled. And I like knowing the bare bones of what's going to happen. Cause then I could go into movies like Last Jedi and know Luke Skywalker dies, but I don't know how they filmed it, edited it. Uh-oh. Well, I said spoilers forever.
Yeah.
That scene was so touching in Last Jedi, even though I knew it was going to happen, it really still had emotional resonance for me because I didn't know how they'd shoot it, edit it. I didn't know Mark Hamill would give the performance of his career. So it was actually a little tricky because the Raven, which I'm sure you're familiar with, Ed, it's not allowing spoilers in their spoiler form, which is a complete head scratcher. Someone there posted full spoilers of the movie. They went to the Cannes Film Festival screening and detailed plot synopsis, and the moderators yanked it, saying no spoilers in the spoiler forum. So it's like, what are people going to be doing for the next month, speculating on what is already known? So I read that. He was nice enough to send me a link to another spot where all of that stuff is, and so I know exactly everything that happens. I'm not going to spoil anything, don't worry.
Good, thank you.
I'm sure it's going to be an entertaining movie, but I'm also sure I'm going to feel the same way about it after I eventually see it. I'm in no rush. That I felt about the first two Star Wars sequel movies I saw. I still have never seen Rise of Skywalker, but it's going to be like an entertaining, you know, ride while it's going on. And then I'm sure a few weeks later, I'm going to be like, oh, I can't believe they did that. So I'll say no more.
I want to know, Ed, personally, what are you most excited for in Dial of Destiny? What potentially has got, you know, you hyped for this one?
All right. So there's a few things, obviously. The first is actually seeing Harrison Ford during World War II. I think Indiana Jones, not Harrison Ford. Well, it is Harrison Ford. Indiana Jones in World War II. I think that is going to be fantastic. You know, it's all been alluded to in Crystal Skull. You know, Ross was talking about his work with I think it was the OSS and everything like that. So I think that's going to be fantastic. And since a lot of us hold near and dear to our hearts, Force 10, you know, from Navarone as well, which is set around that time. And I think we always thought that maybe that was actually Indiana Jones undercover, not the character he was playing. So I'm really excited to see how they go and utilize that and the technology that's helping that happen. So I think that's going to be pretty darn exciting, because I wonder, you know, down the track, obviously this is Harrison Ford's last Indiana Jones film
did you hear about Hugh Jackman's last time as Wolverine and Logan a few years ago?
Correct. And actually, who was directing Logan, and who was directing that again?
Mangold's got a history.
Imagine that.
So look, I certainly think we'll be seeing the character of Indiana Jones again, but in this moment, that's one thing I'm super excited for. Just the whole shebang. I'm just super excited to see another Indiana Jones movie up there on the big screen. There hasn't been enough, in my opinion. I was saying to Michael earlier that we were going, there should have been a few more Indiana Jones films in between Crystal Skull and now. I think if maybe not seven or eight like the Marvel movies dished out, but certainly, maybe at least two would have been fantastic. And this would have been the third one. And then we would have had, a nice, even number to the, what's a double trilogy? I don't know what
Didn't
you call it.
Always say it was going to be five right from the start though.
I'm not sure, but I am surprised even when we last talked, which was a while after Crystal Skull had come out, it still felt like Indy 5 was imminent 12 years ago, and it took them 15 years. And it's like, what was the holdup? And part of it, now we will always wonder, what would another Spielberg Indiana Jones have been after the response to Crystal Skull, taking those criticisms and then going back to the drawing board? But alas, Steven has moved on to other things that it's not really his interest anymore.
Unless he directs a animated version of it, that'd be kind of cool. I think that
could be possible.
I would say never say never,
and let's hope never say never, because as anyone who has watched our show for a long time knows, Spielberg's my guy. That's my favorite dude. And I was saying to Mercy, it is too bad that Indy 5 did take so long that when the opportunity finally came, he chose to do his life story, The Fabelmans, instead. But I think Mangold is capable hands, and I'm very excited to see how they capture the spirit. But I do think now that we're 15 years on from Crystal Skull, which I liked more than a lot of people generally talk about it, I think that the thing that we notice now 15 years on is just some of that reliance on CGI and the new technology was less exhilarating than the first three movies, where we got that great practical and those special effects feel tangible. And, the monkeys and all that stuff in Crystal Skull, you're just like, okay, I'm watching Tintin. So I'm wondering, is Mangold going to find a better balance with Dial of Destiny, or now that we're in the age of the volume and all of that stuff, is it just going to overwhelm us with screens?
Well, I do know they haven't used the volume or any of that sort of technology, and they've tried to do as much practical as they can. But I always say, that those films, the Indiana Jones films and obviously the Star Wars films, were all cutting edge for visual effects at the time. They were using, bleeding edge technology for each of those. So when they go into, people keep going, oh, there's so much bad CGI in Kingdom of the Crystal Skull, which a lot of it is practical. And we've had some stunt performers on who were talking about all this practical stuff, and Doomtown was all practical and everything like that. They're going to be using cutting edge, we're not going to go back to ever to the bad matte lines and, one dimensional matte paintings and things like that. So you sort of, it's, how do you capture that? I don't know. I don't know. I suppose it's a feel. And from what I've got from the trailers and all those little snippets that I have seen, I think it looks like it is in the world of Indiana Jones, but again, with a bit of a modern take. That's my feeling.
Right. We always got to push the medium forward and use the tools that they have of the day, for sure. And hopefully that spirit is the thing that we want. Just that fun sense of adventure.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
This part, I don't know about. I'm hoping that he's not lost in the shuffle like in Kingdom of the Crystal Skull. That was my least favorite part about Crystal Skull. This guy's supposed to be this legendary mythic hero, and there he is, right, next to that guy and behind that girl and that traveling band at the end of Crystal Skull. I don't know how they did that and someone didn't just like especially Spielberg didn't just say stop, we can't do this. Kind of like Matt and I were just talking about Air, Ben Affleck's new movie, and there's that scene when they're given the reel to recruit Jordan, and Damon just pulls the plug on it. He's like, this ain't working, we got to stop. Mm-hmm. I can't believe Spielberg didn't just put the brakes on when he was filming the end of that movie and go, we can't have Indiana Jones walking in a giant group of people for the climax of the movie. I mean, Last Crusade, yeah, he had a big group and then he gets separated and he's on his own, right? And it's all on him. But Crystal Skull was just, I couldn't believe like this traveling band of people. I'm like, why am I searching for Indiana Jones?
Yeah, I feel like they had to I love aspects of Kingdom of the Crystal Skull, and we just released on the IndyCast a commentary where we just watched it again. And for me, each time I watch it, I find something I knew that I really like about it. And I think it's got a special place in my heart because that's where we started the IndyCast, basically, with in the lead up to that. Sure, it's got its issues, and most films do, but yeah, that has a few more. But I agree. I often feel like they sometimes do have too many characters and too many high profile actors that it's hard to sometimes, you know, that's why Star Wars, I think the original Star Wars worked so well, because apart from Peter Cushing, who I vaguely remembered, but as a 7-year-old, no idea. And same with Alec Guinness, everyone else, I had no idea. They were the characters. And
you didn't remember Bob Falfa from American Graffiti?
Yeah, as a 3-year-old, I didn't get out to the cinema that much. Okay. To see American Graffiti. But and even with Raiders of the Lost Ark, you know, obviously I knew it was Indy, but even then he looked a little different, and he wasn't Han Solo. So no, I think that worked. As the films, Sean Connery, I think, is the exception, because I think he just worked perfectly for the role of his father. But in with Kate Blanchett and Ray Winston, and I think there were just, I don't know what it is. And I always go Alan Dale, who played General Ross, who's an Australian actor, who I thought had the worst American accent. I don't know what it is, mate. All my American friends go, he's Australian, and go, oh my God, yeah, can't you tell there's that Aussie twang in there? So a few things took it out. So I think, yeah, just having a few less, you know, characters would be a good thing. So we'll see what you know, Antonio Banderas and some of the others, you know, bring to it. Hopefully they can melt into their roles a little bit more than their actual personas.
And another big thing I'm excited for is Sala, the return of Sala.
Mm-hmm.
So about time John Rhys-Davies has been invited back into the world of Indiana Jones. I'm hoping for a big role there. It's already packed cast, so I don't know. I don't have the best.
I suspect it's you know, maybe bookends or something like that. But it's still awesome to see him there on screen, and still with that you know, sounds exactly the same. And you know, he's such a great. No, I wouldn't even call him a sidekick. You know, he's an equal Sulla. So it's nice to see him on board for some part of the adventure, at least.
So here's one thing I'm not clear on. At this advanced age, they already sort of did this in Crystal Skull with his dad died and Marcus died and like all mm-hmm. of his closest friends died, but he still got Sala, and Sala should be at this point like a brother to him. And you know, the more mm-hmm. you lose people as you age, the stronger the bonds with who's left should become. And if you start losing family, then your friends become your family. And yes. Crystal Skull, I was just left scratching my head going, okay, so he's got a son out of nowhere, which kind of makes him seem like an idiot, like this brilliant archaeologist who found the Ark. He found the Holy Grail, couldn't find his son, didn't have any idea he had a boy. But like, why that movie didn't have Sala really left me scratching my head. Like, okay, so he's lost some family, but where's Sala, and where's Short Round? Like, once again, apparently Short Round not in the new movie. So where is his real son, Short Round?
I think part of it is just, you know, especially when these movies take place, it was harder to keep in touch with people who lived halfway across the world.
Well,
which you know, maybe they're pen pals, but it's boring to show us reading letters from his buddy that he's writing back and forth. It wasn't as easy as I think it would be if they, you know, live so far apart. But I do wonder, now that Kehi Kwan has had such a resurgence, if down the road we may see Short Round come back in some capacity, because for years everybody just forgot that this guy was incredible. Mm-hmm. And luckily last year, everybody now remembers, oh my God, this guy, he's still got it. He's amazing.
Yep.
So wouldn't it be too late if Indiana Jones isn't in the actual movie? Isn't it another case of the Star Wars sequel trilogy where it's like, we wanted the reunion, you know, him coming in after in a spinoff movie. If they continue it without Ford, it's like, this is not what we wanted. We wanted that reunion.
Well, have you seen that? There's some wonderful fan art, or I don't know if it's fan art. It's professional art. It looks fantastic. I think it's like the Adventures of Short Round poster. And I think what a great series that would be. And you could have, you know, Indy doing maybe a bit of the bookends, like in the original Young Indiana Jones Chronicles, perhaps, you know, Mystery of the Blues, you know, he popped up. He could pop up in that. So that would be kind of cool, I think. So yeah. Keeping it in the Indiana Jones world. I know there was rumors talking about that Abner Ravenwood series that was going to happen. I don't know why they chose Abner, you know, I think they're thinking about something like that. So Short Round would be a likely candidate. And he's just appeared in American Born Chinese on Disney Plus. So he's got that sort of link there. So yeah. Who knows?
Tom Selleck as Abner Ravenwood.
Wouldn't that be great stunt casting?
That would be tremendous. If Blue, I don't know, is Blue Blood still on? If that ever goes off the air, maybe he will. But I like that they have talked a lot about possibly some sort of Disney Plus series, but we've also seen now with the streaming bubble kind of shifting that maybe they aren't going to inject as much money into that side of it. But I wonder, there is a lot of potential to do some sort of Indiana Jones adjacent adventures, which
animated, you know, is the way to go. Like
I think so.
That's the medium that seems to usually recapture the old magic, because more often than not, I feel when they bring something back in this era that we're in right now, the 2020s, it seems like, with a few exceptions like Top Gun, the hero's got to be torn down, deconstructed. He's got to be made. He was an idiot all along, didn't you know? Like, he actually was never a hero. He was a con man and a scumbag. And I'm just sick of seeing it. Star Wars, the sequel trilogy was full of it. Mandalorian is thankfully kind of evaded that. But that's why I'm a little cautious about a new Indiana Jones movie. I love Indy, and I love that he's at the forefront, and I love the effect that a new movie has, because it's Crystal Skull all over again. Even though I wasn't the biggest fan of that movie, I loved like the resurgence of indie love. I love that you could get like a good indie replica whip for cheap, you know, and the official indie hat and all the toys. The
figures. That's right.
Yeah. That is the thing. They open the merch floodgates, and they don't just give us the new merch. They give us the classic, you know, tie-ins to Raiders and Temple of Doom and Last Crusade, which is always, it's a shame we had to wait like another 15 years for that stuff to really start ramping up. But I'm excited about a lot of the merch that we got coming our way.
They reissued the old Kenner Indy figures. I always wanted one of those Indy Kenner figures, but I wasn't going to pay.
Got a menagerie of incredible merchandise behind him.
Hasbro was kind enough to send me a box of the first wave of indie stuff, but I've been collecting for ages, and I do have my original still carded Indiana Jones figure from 1982, which I'm going to you know, have to sell if I need to you know, have major surgery or something like that. It's because they're worth it's ridiculous how much they're worth. But it's just wonderful seeing all this new stuff out there. What bugged me was you could get Golden Girls action figures from Reaction, but you couldn't get any Indiana Jones action figures. It was crazy.
Bizarre.
Yeah. Nothing against the Golden Girls, by the way, but
Of course not. I think that there's probably a market for some B. Arthur action figures, but maybe not as much as Indiana Jones. And
I'd prefer a B. Arthur holiday Star Wars holiday special action. That's incredible. What I'd like.
She was a Marine, custom, you know.
Custom made.
Yeah. She should have been a G.I. Joe, actually. If the Sergeant Slaughter deal fell through, they should add B. Arthur as a G.I. Joe. Well, let's talk about that's enough of Dial of Destiny. Let's talk about the real magic, the original trilogy. Ed, can you pick a favorite of the original trilogy?
Look, it's got to be Raiders of the Lost Ark, I think. You know, I love all of the original trilogy Indiana Jones movies, but Raiders of the Lost Ark has a special place in my heart. Obviously, it's the first one I saw. I remember on I've mentioned this before on the IndyCast. The first time there was a TV show on A Current Affair, I think it was on ABC or something like that, one of our TV stations over here. And at the end, they used to have an art section, and they showed what I recall being almost the whole opening temple sequence of, probably wasn't, it was only probably a minute, but it felt like it was the whole sequence on TV. And this was, and I'm going, oh my gosh, because this is in, you know, the days before internet, obviously, and things like that. And again, as an 11-year-old kid, I maybe had one or two Starlog magazines, but I didn't really know anything about this. And I think I was maybe in the Star Wars, in the Bantha tracks. I think I maybe have seen, or was that maybe a little bit later on? But I saw that and going, oh my gosh. And then I think my mum was saying, oh, it's rated, it's NRC. That's what it was. Not recommended for children. I go, how can it be not rated? It looks like, come on. So my dad took me, and it was absolutely amazing, and saw it multiple times after that. And my first, I've got here a picture of me in 1982 dressed up as, you know, Indiana Jones. And I get with a snake wrapped around my fedora, you know, you look at that stuff and you go, oh, did I even have a picture of Indiana Jones to look at? You know, it was sort of like this, gray leather jacket, and you know, it was all inaccurate, but the spirit behind the thought was there. So for me, that is something that was just I don't know what it was. It was just a roller coaster ride. So Raiders for me, and I think it does change. Like Temple of Doom, I have such fond memories of going with my friend Jason Chitty in to see Temple of Doom, and not knowing anything really about it, you know, story beats or anything like that. And I remember us looking at each other when Willie Scott was going down into the lava pit, and we thought, oh my God, she's going to die. She's going to die. And so that was, you know, that was a great moment. And of course, getting to see Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade with my dad, we got tickets to the a preview screening. So we drove up to Melbourne to see it. And then it opened that week, and then the week after, and then I saw it in Geelong. I saw it every week for 10 weeks in a row, every weekend.
Wow.
So, yeah. So it's hard to say, but Raiders, sorry, that was a really long response, but Raiders of the Lost Ark for me.
Well, that's back when Spielberg knew how to make a rewatchable movie, and Matt's wearing the hat. Jaws is the most rewatchable movie I've ever seen. I can put Jaws on today and just be completely pulled into it and like feel like I've never seen it before, even though the whole movie's spoiled. I can watch it, you know, even though I know what's going to happen, I still feel like I don't know what's going to happen.
Yeah,
there are very different movies, even though it's all Indiana Jones. I feel like it depends on what mood you're in. So Raiders to me is like the Oscar movie. It's the slower pace. It's the really finely crafted one with finely crafted performances and more of a patient pace. You have to really, I've tried to just, I've been tired, I put on Raiders. I can't do it. You have to really pay attention to Raiders. It's not just a background noise movie. It's just too damn brilliant. Mm. Temple of Doom is the turn your brain off popcorn action movie. Right. If you just don't want much substance, Temple of Doom, I put that in. And then Last Crusade is the fun action adventure, feel good, you know, slightly kind of feel good father and son reconcile movie. So, yeah, they all have, it's interesting. They all have different feels. And then Crystal Skull. Mm. Crystal Skull is just a modern thing. It's got echoes of the past, but it's more of this how we do things today, pal. Like, oh, great.
Yeah.
Now, even though we had to wait 15 years for a new Indiana Jones, around these parts at like our rep theaters or even at like the major chains, every 2 years or so, there'll be like a Raiders or a Last Crusade screening that pops up. And every time they come back to the big screen, I have to go. So,
yes.
Luckily, Temple of Doom doesn't happen very often, but 5 years ago, one of our local rep theaters in Kitchener, Ontario, they did the trilogy. And so I got to watch all of them in one day. But every time our major chain here is Cineplex. Cineplex, about every 6 months, they bring back either Raiders or Last Crusade, and I'll go every time. So I'm those movies I can watch on repeat whenever. And I think we've been very lucky that in the last few years with 4K, we got the fantastic 4K releases of the original movies. And of course, me being a steelbook nut, I got the 4K original steelbook set that had okay art. And then they brought out individual releases with the brilliant yes. posters. And I had to buy all four, because I'm not going to have just the three that I absolutely love and the one that I like sitting there. So I've got those, but I'm happy that, you know, even though we haven't gotten new movies, this is a series that doesn't leave the pop culture consciousness for very long, because that original trilogy still holds up. And every time I go to these revival screenings, there are always kids who, you know, this is either their first time seeing Indiana Jones or certainly their first time seeing it on a big screen. Mm. And leaving the theater is just all smiles. Everybody is ecstatic and have had this great time. And it's the magic is still there. And there's nothing better than when you can enjoy that, you know, in the best quality with the best sound. It's just still a thrill.
Oh, absolutely. I think these films are made for cinemas. And I think, you know, as a teacher, you know, you see so many students who are, you know, either sadly ripping films or they're watching them on their phones and then you go, oh my gosh, oh,
Lord,
this is not the way. I mean, I've got, I think, a 60-inch 4K TV and a 4K player. And we've got a Dolby Atmos system, and it's wonderful. We just watched yesterday in 4K Guardians of the Galaxy, because we haven't seen the third one yet. So we're trying to, as a DC guy, not a Marvel guy, I'm just trying to refresh my memory yep. a little bit before we go see it on the weekend. And it's great, but there is no substitute for being in that darkened room with a bunch of indie fans or just, you know, movie fans. And just experiencing it. It's wonderful. So I think that's going to be really exciting. I'm very excited. I'm going to the opening in LA. I'm flying out in a couple of weeks, which will be exciting to see it. But also I'm going to see it in IMAX in Connecticut with Mitch and a few of the indie casters. So this is going to be the most expensive movie I've ever paid to see. But I think it's going to be worth it. And it's that experience as well that comes with it, you know. So, again, so like King of the Crystal Skull might not be your favorite movie, but all those emotions and feelings that are attached to it, I can't detach from it. So that's why, you know, I quite enjoy watching it.
It can be a convention, a reason to gather. So
yep.
in that respect, who even cares what happens in the movie? Like, you can literally get, I don't know, Matt, what's a horrible movie?
I don't
say Radioland Murders. Legion. Radioland Murders Legion. Is an awesome movie.
Legion. People could get together to watch Legion, and you know, it's like in Lord of the Rings. Still, if the company is good, then it doesn't.
Is that is that the Paul Bettany Legion? Yeah. Or the other? Isn't there two versions of Legion?
I think there is two different. Yeah. There's a TV show that came afterwards that
threw it in the garbage. We reviewed it on here, and as a joke, as a goof. We didn't say a word, and we just
dropped it in the trash.
We dropped it in the trash, and that was our review. It was like a 10-second review, you know, intro music. There we are looking not pleased, and we dropped it in the trash. And then
so what did you think of it, though?
And then I forgot, like it was a joke, but I forgot it was in there, and off it went into the garbage. I had all intentions to pull it out of the garbage and, you know, at least give it to somebody or something. Yeah. But it was gone. And then I needed it for some reason. And it was gone. I was like, oh my God, I didn't check the garbage. Well, like I literally threw that in the garbage.
Yeah.
I
you gotta remember that no one sets out to make a bad movie. Absolutely. And everyone goes in to make it. And there's and people are fans of, you know, everything. You probably offended three people, you know, who were fans of Legion. They weren't legions of fans, but they were fans of Legion.
I'm sure
offending people.
In five years from now, you know, Scream Factory or Vinegar Syndrome will release some deluxe Legion and people will be reclaiming it. But as you mentioned, Ed, I'm super excited for the IMAX to see, you know, Mangold using the remastered version of this technology to see, you know, Indy in this pristine format,
mm-hmm.
And I think it's exciting that, you know, you can use this movie as an excuse, partly to come stateside, catch up with friends. And I know you're going to New York and you got a lot of stuff planned that you're going to be doing, and to have Indiana Jones just be part of the ether because it's in that moment is going to make it even more memorable down the road.
I agree. And it's just been like indie fans are wonderful. Certainly the ones that I deal with, and it's just shared passion and enthusiasm, and everyone is just wonderful. So Mitch was going, oh my God, what happens if the movie's really bad? And go, you know what? I don't think it will be. It probably won't be perfect, because like with the prequels and after the original trilogy sequel called
Force Away.
The Abrams, it's not the OT, it's the
they just whatever used to call it the sequel trilogy now.
The sequel trilogy. So, they could never live up to all those years of what we had dreamed and hoped for, but it's going to be fun. It's going to be fun regardless, I think, you know. And look, John Williams never does a bad score. So I think at the very least, we're going to have a wonderful Indiana Jones score from the maestro.
I think no matter what happens on screen there, your take on it is going to be very similar to Jason and Jimmy from Rebel Force Radio. They've watched some bad Star Wars movies or movies they didn't enjoy, or maybe downright really did not enjoy. But it's just the attitude. You know, are you going to spend your time just crying about it and slagging it and acting like a victim? Or are you going to try to find the silver lining? Mm. And there's going to be, I'm sure, lots of good stuff about the movie. You know, as even though Crystal Skull is my least favorite Indiana Jones movie, I kind of got the hankering to put it in and just watch it again. Rather than watch Dial of Destiny anytime soon. But that's just, you know, that's how it goes, because nothing is all bad. And I think to say it's all bad is really closed-minded and not at all realistic. That's the whole point of armchair directors, best part, worst part. You know, like we have given a worst part on some of the most universally loved movies and gotten a lot of hate for it. Like, how dare you? And we've given a best part on some universally hated movies. And same thing, how dare you? Well, because nothing is all good or all bad.
Yep.
And I do think Ed made a great point about John Williams. And I think even people who don't love the Star Wars sequel trilogy, there are some incredible themes that he came up with in that. The soundtracks are dynamite and he still got it. And knowing now that, you know, he announced his retirement and then retracted it, that we don't have very many of these John Williams scores left, that no matter what, the fact that we're getting him working in the Indiana Jones world again is so special that, you know, this guy towards the end of his career is getting a chance to remind a lot of new people why he is the maestro, why he is the master. And I think, I'm happy to add this soundtrack to my collection when it comes out. I can't wait. I listen to even Crystal Skull. I listen to that soundtrack all the time because it's incredible. And Williams giving us more Indiana Jones themes. I can't wait at the prospect. I'm super excited for that. No matter.
Absolutely. And Mangold said, you know, I think there's 2 hours plus of John Williams score. So hopefully we get, an expanded, score at some point. But yeah, it's just gonna, I can't wait. It's just, there's so much excitement, you know, because again, I've been avoiding spoilers, and which is hard when you're running an Indiana Jones podcast.
Right.
Yeah. And all of us, we're trying, like, you can't, even some review headlines are going, oh, look, we're not going to read reviews, because if I read reviews, I wouldn't have seen John Carter, and I love John Carter. It's one of my favorite movies.
Great movie.
You know, there's all the, you know, so I'll make up my own mind, apart from Legion, of course, now, because I trust you guys. But, you know, so just,
hey, it's Bettany was exciting great in time.
It. Sorry?
Bettany was great in it.
Oh, well, there you go. He's usually pretty good in, even in Mordecai, he's not too bad. So there you go.
What I gotta ask both of you guys, what would be the deal breaker for you? What would be the one thing that you'd be like, or is this movie just going to be impossible to hate, at least for the time being? Like, just too happy that he's back, that they actually did it and love it no matter what. Is there a deal breaker where you'd go, you know what, I can't go along with that?
Well, I think, you know, if Indy acts contrary to his character, or does things that I think that he wouldn't do, maybe that's always, I always have one problem with Last Crusade is, what happened to Marcus? Why did Marcus change so much from Raiders of the Lost Ark to Last Crusade in that 3 years? How long was he lost in that museum? Maybe it was 3 years.
Yeah.
And that would affect you. I get that. But, you know,
Sola too, to some extent, in Last Crusade.
Yeah.
Both of them just became comic relief.
Yeah, a little bit. So I know, obviously, that Indy's not going to be the Indy of old, at least.
Oh, he's going to be the Indy of old.
Well, okay. Yeah. Well done. So. And, you know, there's been talk of, like, we've been saying, this is our assumptions. No, this is just on the IndyCast. We've been saying, well, we think that Marion and Mutt have passed on. So something's happened. Again, don't give us any flinches or anything, please, Michael, just to, you know, to give it away. But this is what we were sort of thinking. Maybe Mutt's, he died in Vietnam. You know, maybe that's it. So that's why... That's why we don't see, you know, we don't see them, you know, something like
my dog, something like that.
That's all right. Will Indy die at the end? Okay. That could happen. You know, we've seen it in Bond. We've seen it like that. I don't think I want to see that necessarily, you know, but I don't think it'll be a deal breaker. You know, if Helena Shaw says, you know what, I'm actually, you know, Helena Skywalker at the end of the movie, you know, or something, and puts on the fedora, I might be a little going, hang on, let's have a Helena Shaw movie, not a Helena Jones movie. But I don't know. I'm so just going in, you know, with enthusiasm.
So basically, taking the iconic hero and a forced arbitrary passing of the torch, which same for me, I cannot stand that forced, we're passing the torch. You don't pass the torch. If it works, the new person, the new dynamic person yanks the torch, they steal it. I can't think of any time that someone has passed the torch and said, here, love him now, or love her. You will love this new character. It does not work. It has to be this lightning in a bottle type of, ooh, what's this shiny new toy? So
that's why I like the end of Crystal Skull, where, you know, the hat gets blown at the chapel. And Mutt goes to grab the hat, and then Indy takes it away. And I like that because you're going, yeah, there's no substitute. And, you know, I wouldn't have mind seeing the adventures of Mutt Williams, because I thought, as a character, I thought it worked well within that, you know, that greaser sort of vibe and everything like that. But that was not to be. So, yeah, I'd hate to, I don't know. Like, yeah, Short Round for sure I could get behind, or that, but that's Short Round. It's not Indiana Jones. So as long as he's not a, you know, muted by, and from the action sequences that I've seen in the trailer, you know, boy, if I could do that at my age, let alone at 80, I think I'd be happy to, you know, I'd be a happy person. So
absolutely. I think it's a pretty safe bet that, and I'm not spoiling anything here. This isn't part of what I read. This is just speculation on my part, but I think it's a safe bet that Ford would not allow anything that's not Indy like to happen in the movie. Ford yes. has the authority to say Indy wouldn't say that. And Ford is Indy and Indy is Ford. And I'm sure Mangold would listen if that would have been sorted out, you know, before when the script was written. Ford would mm-hmm. be saying Indy wouldn't do that. Indy wouldn't say that. So that's, I don't think there's anything to worry about there. But Matt, what would be a deal breaker for you?
Yeah, I don't have any set deal breakers. There are probably, especially because I don't want to speculate the worst things that could happen in the movie. But I am very tired of the trope that we did mention where you do another movie and bring back the character that we love only to have them pass away by the end of it. Mm. And just because they are getting older, I'd rather even if this is Harrison Ford's last one, a ride off into the sunset moment rather than we're putting him in the ground moment.
Cause he's a cowboy.
And even just like people say, you know, the great TV shows are often ones where they end, but in your mind, you know, the characters carry on, right?
Yes.
Because there's no definitive ending to like their actual story. And I think that is something that movies, that even when we revisit these, as long as we end them in a place where we can imagine they go on, then
the adventure continues with Kenner action figures.
Right. And even if the adventure never continues, the fact that we didn't close the book entirely is the thing that's important to me. So I hope that, you know, we do this in a way that at the end, even if I don't love the movie, Indy gets the proper send off that has the potential that no matter what happens after this, his adventure goes on.
Well, that's like in Picard, the final season of Picard, where, you know, I thought, they all made it through and it was perfect. It was absolutely perfect. And they're still living their lives in the 23rd century or whenever it is. I don't know. But, you know, I think that's kind of great. And then, you know, then we could get some novels after that or comic books or everything like that. Yeah, please don't. Again, I'm not looking at you. I don't want to look at you, Michael, because I don't want to see if you flinch or anything like that.
No, I haven't given anything away today.
You know, so if he dies, but I trust that the people behind the scenes know what they're doing. And I know a lot of people go, well, why did they do this? And I'm sure they put a lot of thought into it. And it's not just like let's kill Indy or let's do this. You know, there was a reason that they do these things. Why they killed Admiral Akbar and then didn't give any sort of anything to it, that I don't understand.
Terrible.
Yeah. Where was the reverence for Akbar? That took me out. That really annoyed me. But for a larger character like Indy, he better save the world, or maybe who knows? Maybe he'll end up in ancient Rome and he's just living his life in a vineyard like Picard. Who knows?
Spoilers.
Is that a spoiler?
I think you know more about it than I do, Ed.
You made a great point about Picard, which was I watched the first season of Picard and then dropped out, and then I heard from Mercy and some other people that season 3 was incredible.
Oh, yeah.
So I, of course, watched it all, and just the magic and reverence for those characters and having everybody just pop up and we get through this massive thing. And even if we never see them again, they're just off doing their thing from now on. And that's the way you do it.
In the D, no less. So not only did they bring the crew back.
Right back to the spot you want to see them.
They Days of Future Past it. They fixed something that was screwed up in the past and retroactively fixed it. So, yeah, that was.
Yeah, that was a lot of thought was put into that final season, because I know with sort of one, I sort of enjoyed the first season. Oh, yeah, this is okay. Season 2, I think, didn't even need to happen, really. And then season 3 was like a whole different. I was watching a movie. It was, you know, they did a wonderful course correction. And I loved it. So let's hope, you know, that the same is for Indy. And again, I think with the reverence that they have for the character, I think we won't see anything, hopefully, horribly bad happened to the characters, but I would recommend Matt that you don't read the back of the soundtrack before you see the film.
Ever since the Phantom Menace, I never make that mistake again. And even if I listen to something on Spotify before it comes out, I don't look at the track names anymore.
Was one of them, especially now,
when we're a month away. Yes. So it's like, all right, we're a month away. I'm just excited and hyped.
Yeah, I remember in Australia, they had a special on TV, like a 90-minute special about The Phantom Menace coming out with an entertainment reporter. And then they looked at the other Star Wars films and everything like that. And of course, she goes, and then Qui-Gon dies. And this was like a month before the film came out. And boy, did she get hate mail that day. Oh, I bet. It was
even like, that's a good case of what I was saying earlier, that even if you have a morsel of information, you don't necessarily know what's going to happen, how it's going to be handled in the movie. So I think it's so silly, the tantrums that people throw. You gave me a plot point. Like, that doesn't mean you've seen the plot point happen in the movie. So I think I knew Qui-Gon died in the movie, but I just assumed Force ghost. Like, you gotta die if you're gonna be a Force ghost. So
well, true.
Right on. Like, let's do it. And what was surprising to me is that he signed a one picture deal.
Like, yes.
Oh, that sucked. It wasn't until the second one came out that I realized, oh, that really sucked. He's yeah, gone for good.
And certainly that's an instance where once the Duel of the Fates kicks off and you're into the scene, even when you know what the ultimate thing is going to be, because you can figure, oh, this must be where it happens, it's still just thrilling. It's
still the best
duel
ever.
I just remember going to see Return of the Jedi in 83, and I went with a friend of mine who is American, Frank. He had seen the film, because in Australia it would come out, you know, like 6 months after the fact. And he was sitting next to me and he was going, and this is where Leia strangles Jabba.
Oh no. Oh,
and this is where, I think that's why I have a bit of an aversion to spoilers, right? Because I really, because I couldn't enjoy, I couldn't see it for the first time. I felt like that. So I'm trying to avoid as much as I can.
I don't look up the spoilers to spoil other people. I think that's reprehensible. Yeah. People who do that. Yeah. And yes, there, you have some responsibility. Don't go on Twitter and then cry that, oh, you gave it away. Like, you, people have to be responsible, and it's hard to completely stay off the internet, especially if you do work through the internet, but you can tone it down a bit. Mm-hmm. You know, the really responsible people are the ones who take a step back and just kind of are low key about it. But I don't go after spoilers to ruin the movie for other people. I go and read the spoilers because I've made a few films. And so the shock, it doesn't really affect me. I don't know if it's the same for you, Matt, but it doesn't affect me the way it affects most other people, because I know how the sausage is made. So I like, just watched Air, and I was in awe of Air. Just like, wow, what a brilliant decision, and what a great technique, and oh, this is awesome. Oh, I didn't see that coming. That was brilliant. I just sit there going, brilliant, good job, good job, good job. So movies aren't free if you're going to go to the theater. And I just think it's really weird how people are like, well, I'm going to put my money down and then I'm going to see if it was worth it. Like, no, you don't have to do that. You can actually read reviews, or even if you want to spoil it all and go, you know what, despite everything I read, I'm still going to give it a shot. And at least that way you're not kicking yourself like, oh, what a waste of $15. So that's why I do it. And when I, you know, read the spoilers, if everything had been hunky dory and it was like, you know what, that would have fit right between Temple of Doom and Raiders. If he wasn't 80, that could have been a 35-year-old Indiana Jones in this story. I would have been there opening night right beside Matt. Like, let's do it. Mm-hmm. But I read the spoilers because I know who's making the movie, and I'm not talking about Mangold. I'm talking about his boss, and I've seen mm-hmm. what she's done to Star Wars. So I was like, I'm hoping for the best, but read the spoilers, and it's going to be a super entertaining movie. Don't let me doom and gloom you. You're going to walk out. I'm pretty sure everyone's going to walk out happy and very, very entertained. But I've just got baggage about certain things that I've just got baggage. So some things that really irritate me, other people are like, hey, who cares? What's the big deal? Like, I watched The Force Awakens, not to make any parallels about anyone getting killed or anything. That's not what I'm doing mm-hmm. here. But Force Awakens really killed a lot of my love for modern Star Wars and enthusiasm for modern Star Wars after Han Solo got skewered by his son. I went, that does not happen in Star Wars movies. George Lucas fought tooth and nail against that type of awful horribleness. Like, there's hands get cut off and people are pushed to the brink of exhaustion and pain, but that doesn't happen. And all of a sudden this person who's doing this movie is like, well, it happens now. I'm like, okay, go ahead and do whatever you want with it. Have all the fun you want. I'm not telling you stop making these movies. I'm just saying I'm out. So this one, just to put your mind at ease, it's not as bad as The Force Awakens was or Last Jedi, but there's just a few things that I went, it's a 2023 movie.
And we'll see, because anybody who watches us know I think Force Awakens is a top three Star Wars film and is absolutely incredible.
Didn't you see that one twice in theaters?
Yeah, I saw Force Awakens about four or five times and I still maintain, I don't care what happens after that, that is a perfect Star Wars movie. That is just an entertaining, great 130 minutes that I absolutely love. So we'll see. I don't have any issues with that, but I think that shows how subjective and it's all personal taste and opinion, because you know, if this indie movie is on a par with The Force Awakens, then I'm going to absolutely love it.
Wonderful.
Awesome. And I'm going to be wearing
I thought The Force Awakens was pretty, the only thing I didn't like, I mean, obviously Han getting skewered, as you said, wasn't great, but the only thing at the start, I just wished it wasn't Max von Sydow, it was General Madine. Why wasn't it General Madine or Wedge? That's all I want. That's the only change I would have liked to have seen.
It wasn't Wedge, because he wouldn't have anything to do with it at that point. He was asked,
until the third film, when you're going, who's that old guy in that? Right.
He caved by the third one for the I know. Page.
Oh, he have you watched Star Wars Visions? It's great to see Wedge actually in that. So there's a nice I think that's in the Aardman animation one. It's pretty fun.
In the new one from the Visions 2 that just came out.
Lawson is the uncle of Ewan McGregor, and he actually warned his nephew to not be in Star Wars movies and stay away from it. But you know, he came around himself.
And instead he found fortune and glory, which is a fitting thing for what we were actually talking about.
There you go. Yeah. Nicely done.
Let's close out here. Almost at an hour here, talking about the IndyCast, how that started, how long it's been going on, and some of the highlights and where to find.
Oh gosh, we've been going since we started in November 2007. So we've been going for quite a long time. We're one of the oldest continual running podcasts that are out there. You know, a lot have come and gone, but we've never had I think the extended break we've probably had is like a 3 or 4 week break in between episodes. So we've been pretty consistent then.
Same here.
Yeah. So, you know,
3 or 4 months.
Yeah. So we were at one point, I think at the height of Crystal Skull, we were doing a weekly episode, and we, you know, it was amazing. We're in the top 20 iTunes in the United States and things like that. It was wonderful. And obviously things petered off and we've gone to our monthly, and even in the lead up to our Dial of Destiny, just because all of us, we're all a lot, you know, 15 years older, with jobs and everything else. I've got a YouTube show with Mitch that I do as well every other week, and just a bit busy, but you know, we're still going strong. We've had some wonderful guests, Karen Allen. We've had John Reese Davis. We've had
didn't you have Mathew Crandall on there one time?
Well, he was the highlight. Oh my gosh, absolutely. You know, there's
somewhere in the archives we're there.
That's right.
I bet John Rhys Davies was like, I heard you had Crandall on the show. How do I follow that?
He did. He did. He refused to actually go on after. So, so you know, thanks for that. We've had Drew Struzan on, which was wonderful. Cool. We've had some amazing, you know, comic book artists and talent behind the scenes and on. And we've had a great run, and we're looking forward to actually catching up. In 2017, I headed over for our 10th anniversary of the show and to the United States, and we did some meet and greets and met up with some wonderful fans and part of the team. So we're doing that again in just a couple of weeks, actually. So it's going to be great to catch up and, you know, go on the indie ride with a lot of the indie fans over there in Disneyland, and then catching up with the movie in New York and in Connecticut. And I could recommend, if you are in Connecticut, look up Mitch, and he does a wonderful Kingdom of the Crystal Skull tour. You know, it's fantastic because you get to go, well, sneak into where the actual classroom was, where Indy is in Crystal Skull, and the dining hall and all that. And you can, it's great to actually see some physical locations from an Indiana Jones movie. So if you're in the area, it's well worth looking around New Haven.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
And with Dial of Destiny, love it or hate it, the IndyCast will be there and will still be a great place to celebrate Indiana Jones. So I just want to remind people that your love of Indiana Jones, or any franchise for that matter, doesn't rest on how the new movie performs, or how it makes it. Certainly doesn't rest on how it performs. This whole thing of it bombed, it must have sucked, or it made a lot of money, so it was good. That's gotta go away. But who am I kidding? It'll never go away. But definitely, like, the how the newest movie plays, who cares? I just love that there's Rebel Force Radio for Star Wars. I can put that on, and despite how I feel about Star Wars nowadays, I can always put on Rebel Force Radio, and those guys always make it fun to talk about Star Wars. And the same goes for the IndyCast. Same thing, Indiana Jones. They can make another 10 movies that I'm not crazy about, but the IndyCast will be there celebrating Indiana Jones, which is right up my alley. Celebrating heroes, not deconstructing them. So thank you.
Absolutely.
I just want to take a moment to say thank you for doing that, for all the indie fans, to keep the you know, the horse going, and just keep indie relevant and just kind of current, you know, even if there isn't a movie, hasn't been one for 15 years. It's nice that there has been some, you know, regular content being put out by you on the IndyCast, just, you know, trivia, behind the scenes stuff, interviews and stuff, just to keep it in the ether.
Yeah, I love it too, Ed. It's great. And, you know, listening to your epic, you know, 3 to 4 hour episodes once a month, where we get into the nitty gritty of the merch and all that stuff, is great and helps keep the spirit alive, even when we don't have something to celebrate at the time. So it's very good for the fans. And if you haven't checked it out, be sure it's on everywhere you find podcasts and stuff like that.
I appreciate that. Thank you. We try and be as positive as we can. And, have that positive energy. And because everyone loves, we said it before, everyone loves some aspect of the films. And, you know, I'm not certainly going to diss someone for liking something that I don't like. You know, there's enough of that online. Let's be as positive as we can. And I don't know if we're going to be going for another 16 years as a podcast. I'm not sure if I've got it, but you know, we'll keep making it up as we go, and we'll see how we end up. But so excited about Dial of Destiny. It's just going to be a fun experience.
Yeah. I do appreciate podcasts like the IndyCast, and I'll always recommend Rebel Force Radio out there too, and What's on Joe Mind as well. Those are the three podcasts I listened to regularly when I was working in an office job, going for my lunch walk break, putting on What's on Joe Mind with Mike Irizarry there about G.I. Joe, and Rebel Force Radio, which used to be the Force Cast, and the IndyCast as well. So I think it's just cool that you're still doing it. You're still kicking, and you got a new movie to celebrate. And hopefully, like I said, regardless of how it does or what the reception is, I think the floodgates are open. I think we're going to get a new animated series, because what is it to them to do an animated series? Nothing. They just throw a little bit of money at some department who makes like a better thing than the new movie might be. case in point, Tron Legacy, which was a great movie. And then they were like, you guys go and do this Uprising cartoon. And that thing was like almost as good as the movie, if not better. It was fantastic.
Secrets of the Mogwai is fantastic. I don't know if you've caught that.
I have no idea what that is.
It's not in Canada, and it's killing me. It's the new Gremlins cartoon show that just started this week, and it's not available in Canada.
Are you kidding me?
And I've been counting down the years to new Gremlins content.
What is it? It is prequel, sequel?
It's a prequel. It's set in 1920s China. A friend of mine, AJ, does the voice of Gizmo.
Oh,
and
amazing.
Ming-Na Wen and oh my gosh, I've forgotten the guy's Lopan from
James Hong. China. No
James way. Hong, BD Wong. It's
incredible.
It's great. Cast. It's really good fun. So like Muppets Mayhem, you know, they've captured the
magic,
the spirit feel of. So let's hope Indy 5 does that in the Dial of Destiny. So
absolutely, I think that's a great spot to end it. And with that, thanks so much, Ed. If you guys are watching and you have any indie thoughts, hit the comments. Let us know how pumped you are for Dial of Destiny or how much you love the original movie.
Thanks a lot for watching, and until next time,
enjoy the show.